Now it's full screen. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. I really thank you, sir, for giving me this opportunity. I know hair transplant is going to be a very big topic to cover. I have tried my best to cover as much as possible. The intention has not been just the exams or, you know, point of view of studying, because exam mein kya hai ki you not get so many questions out of it, but hair transplant is a very important topic once you come out in practice. There is a lot of competition in this field between, you know, different faculties who are jumping in to do hair transplantation. But as a plastic surgeon, I believe every plastic surgeon should be able to do hair transplantation, because it's such a very nice procedure. It gives you a superb satisfaction at the end of the day when you see the results is going to be marvelous. And having your own center, even the financial point of view, the satisfaction point of view, it is very good. So without wasting much time, I will get into the details of hair transplantation. It has been around for last 50 years. And it has gone through a different eras. You know, the era of surgical era was there when we used to do the jury flap, the scalp reduction surgeries. That gave way to the plug era, where they used to take 2-3 follicular units, a larger plug, and put it in the donor recipient area. Now the plug area was probably one of the worst times, because there were a lot of unnatural results. Results which did not meet the expectation of nor the surgeon nor the patient. And in last 10-15 years, because of the concept of follicular units, it has revolutionized this whole field of hair transplant. Because the most important thing is it started giving very natural appearing results. It was safe, and there is a substantial cosmetic improvement with this procedure. And it is one of the most common cosmetic surgery performed in a male patient. Now, what is the concept of follicular unit? Now, if we were to trim the hairs and look under the microscope, we are going to find that our hairs are actually, you know, growing in families. You could have a family of one, family of 2 units, 3 units. So this was something which was first recognized by Dr. Rasserman in USA, and he started separating these follicular units. It later found out that every particular follicular unit has its own sebaceous gland, and it functions like one complete unit. So separating these units and putting the head, putting it in the front recipient area gave way to the natural appearance. So if you can, have a single mean to, but in Indians, you know, the average, when you read average, you know, when you read it from a book like Ungar or Lamb's book, you know, they talk about average being 2, 2.2, but that is all fine in a Caucasian patient. But in Indian patient, you need to realize that the Indian hairs are more thicker. The number of hairs which we are having per follicular unit is lesser than the Caucasians. Our average is anywhere between 1.7 to 2.2, where a Caucasian patient starts off with 2 hairs per graft, and it can go up to 2.4, 2.5 hairs per graft. But when you compare those results with Indians, you will not have the same number of hairs per graft ratio. So the other thing about hair transplantation, about the thing we need to understand about androgenetic alopecia, that it is a progressive loss. Now a patient who starts off with grade 1 keeps on progressing up to grade 7. Now we do not know whether he is going to progress or he is going to, you know, stop. So one thing very important is, it makes it very important that when we are operating on patients who are grade 2 or grade 3 and they are young, suppose you have a 25-year-old person with grade 2 who walks into your OPD for hair transplantation, you need to be very careful when you are operating. One thing that you need to mention is that your hair loss can get worse. You may lose the hairs on the backside. If you fail to mention these kind of things, it is only, you know, you are going to dig your own grave, because in another 2 years, 3 years, there is a very good chance that he will lose those hairs. एंड ही इज गोइंग टू ब्लेम यू दैट आपने हेयर ट्रांसप्लांट किया इसलिए मेरे पीछे के बाल भी चले गए. सो इज समथिंग विच यू रियली नीड टू बी केयरफुल. इवन वॉट एवर ग्रेड ही कम्स इन देर इज ऑलवेज अ चांस दैट ही इज गोइंग टू लूज द हेयर. Now it becomes very important that we preserve the donor area. Now, donor area preservation is probably one of the most crucial part of hair transplantation. What we need to do is that we got to make sure we are doing least number of damage when we are going to take the hairs from the scalp. Okay. Now there are different classification methods which are used for androgenetic alopecia. The Norwood classification is the most standard one which is used. It is not a complete one, but it is a very easy to understand and easy to grasp. The one which is very complete is the basic and specific type, B and S it is called. It gives you all different patterns, but it is more confusing, a little bit more cumbersome to use in a day-to-day life. But yes, if you're writing a paper or if you're having some presentations, then this would be very useful. The other classification in females is more, Norwood female classification is more complicated. The one simpler one which is used in female is the Ludwig classification, where it is divided into three different types depending upon the hair loss. Now coming to the concept of safe donor zone. Now this has been, you know, talked about and debated like anything, because it was Dr. Unger who did a study in, you know, these patients who were people who were 80, 85 years old. And what he realized is that there is one particular zone which is marked in blue over here. This is the zone which never goes. You know, he saw that patients who are 85 also have the hairs in this region. They may lose hairs on the top or bottom, but this they hardly lose. So he classified that if you take follicular units using the FUT method from here, you are going to see the longest survival of the hairs. During, as the FUE started becoming more and more popular, Cole came out with his own classification. Of course, the zone has been expanded more than what was there in Unger's. It has little bit more on the top and bottom, obviously, because you need a bigger area to get the same number of grafts in FUE. So this difference, you know, there was a lot of debate that FUT takes from a very safe zone, those hairs never go, FUE, the hairs will go away very fast. And, you know, there's a lot of debate which was going on probably 2 years, 3 years back. But practically, there is nothing like an absolutely safe zone. Nobody will be able to tell that the transplanted graft are going to survive. How long they are going to survive? People claim 25 years, 30 years, 50 years, lifelong, but they do not survive for that long. Whatever it is, you will definitely see a decrease in the density, whether you have done FUT or whether you have done FUE. Over time, say around 5 years, 7 years, 10 years, you are definitely going to see a decrease in the density of the transplanted hairs. So the investment the patient is making, if he's looking at it from a point of view of investment for 7 years, 10 years, he's not going to be disappointed. But if you are promising lifelong, you know, then there is a chance that the patient may get disappointed over time. And mind you, it happens even with FUT. And one more thing, if you have any questions in between, please ask me. So it would be more interactive and it would be better for me also. Now, coming to FUT. In FUT, the simplest, as being a plastic surgeon, this is probably a very, you know, what you can say. This was a time when I used to do a lot of FUTs. I felt more like a surgeon. Doing FUE, you don't feel more like a surgeon because, you know, once we do not, FUT involves excision of this scalp and suturing it up and making sure we use a trichophytic closure to make sure that the scar is absolutely minimal. Now, it is from this strip that we are going to, you know, extract our hairs. So there are two other steps which are added. One is a slivering and then is a cutting method. What we do in slivering is, once we have this strip, we are going to cut it like how we cut a bread. Bread ko kaise apne wo loaf of bread ko sliver karte hai. So that same way we got to sliver it out over here. And from these slivers, we are going to get these kind of graphs. So again, you can have a single graph, double graph, triple graph. Now the thing about FUT is that the slivering and cutting is done mainly by the technicians. So you absolutely have no control over what is happening over here. So if you are still practicing FUT, it is absolutely mandatory that you keep a control over your technicians. Because, you know, one bad day he's fought with his wife and he's crushing those grafts and he's cutting them. You have no idea what he's doing because you are busy suturing and he's busy, you know, damaging your grafts. So you need an absolute control when you're going to do FUT, your technicians. You should have FUE has expanded in leaps and bounds in the past few years. It is best used as a very important part of the treatment along with FUT and body hairs. Now, body hairs has all evolved because of FUE. Obviously, there's no scope of doing FUT over there. FUE is here not to replace anybody, but to augment the treatment modalities. Now, if you talk a little, very little about the anatomy, what we need to know is that you have to divide this particular follicular unit into a superior segment and an inferior segment from the point of view of FUE extraction. It is this part, you know, the erector pili attachment that is very important for us because we need to cut this erector pili attachment. Only then we will be able to extract these hairs very easily. Now, there is a difference over here when you read the, you know, text of foreign books. There is always a mention that, you know, they were mentioning they will not go more than 3 mm or 2.5 mm. And, you know, it's very difficult to standardize this. How deep you should go, because it all depends how is the follicular attachment to the surrounding tissue. In some patients, even if you go up to 3 mm, the grafts will pop out very easily, and in some patients you may have to go the entire length of follicular units, and this is where the challenge comes in. Now, once you have to go deep, there is always a chance that you might end up damaging the grafts at the root level. The transaction rate increases once you start going inside, because here there will always, the grafts are always played. So this becomes very crucial. So you need to know that, you know, it's not about one depth is standardized. It varies from patient to patient. The other important thing you need to understand is that the follicular units are located there is an eccentric location. You know, on one end, you have the follicular unit. When you see the cut section, you will see the follicular units or the hairs on one side, and on the other side, you will see all the sebaceous glands. So this becomes very important when you are trying to, you know, extract them. Your punch should be, you should be slightly off center. The aim, you know, your punch, if your punch is, you know, on the lower part, if this is your circular punch, your aim of this should be somewhere in the lower part. This hair should somewhere fall on the lower part to minimize the transections. Now, coming to the different devices which we use in follicular unit extraction, there is a manual device, there is motorized, and there is robotic. It is a manual one with which everything started. You know, initially they started using manual. Now you have to use, you know, once you roll your fingers around, you're definitely going to get oscillatory movements. Now, manual is very good for skin where it is very thin. You know, the Caucasian skin is a little bit more softer than the Indian skin. So probably a manual punch works very well when you are doing these European patients and all. But in Indian patients, it becomes very tedious to do manual extractions. Because one is that when you have a sharp punch in the initial part, it is very good. As soon as your punch starts becoming blunt, you are going to have a lot of problems. So you need to keep changing the punch very often. The rotation is what is standardized and used nowadays. Most of the places in the world, you will find rotation. It is the European countries where still manual is being used largely. Here the rotation is provided by the motor. It is less tedious. You can harvest more number of grafts per hour. But at the same time, there is more twisting. And we will be speaking about motorized in detail in this as we go further. Now, motorized has largely been classified into three particular kind of motors depending upon what is the kind of motion we get. Now, you have these rotatory motors. You know, it is the Harris or the Coles. Or even if you see the micro motor which we use, it gives you only one kind of movement, that is a rotation. There is no way that you can change the rotation or the movement in between. Now, to simulate the manual extraction, Dr. Devaroy developed these oscillatory motors. He believed that when he was doing oscillation, the number of transactions were way less than when he shifted over to rotation. So he developed a valve device. The only issue with the valve device, it's a very good device. It produces very lesser number of transactions than the rotatory motor, but it is very tedious and very slow. Because in this, you got to go through the oscillatory movements in the upper part also. You have to oscillate in this area, which is a very tough part of the skin. So it slows down the whole process. Now, to go beyond this, a Mamba motor came into play. What Mamba motor is, it is a completely mixed movement. You can standardize, you can customize whichever movement you want. Like you can have a rotation first and then an oscillation once we start going deeper. I will speak about Mamba motor as we go ahead. And then the third method is ALTAS. ALTAS is the robotic system which actually was being developed mainly by, you know, a group of surgeons from America. And it is all based on the concept of Dr. James Harris. Now, Harris was the first person to realize that he needed a stronger force in the upper segment and a weaker force in the lower segment. So what he did, he started using sharp punches in the upper segment. And once he came in the lower segment, he used a blunt punch. But to do it manually was very difficult. You know, imagine putting a sharp punch here, removing the sharp punch and then putting a blunt punch. It was a very tedious thing. So he developed a robot to do that job. Now, the logic is very good. The engineering of ALTAS is even better. But the problem was that it is a punch-in-punch technique. It is a sleeve-in-sleeve technique. That is, there is a punch. On top of it, there is another punch. So the hole which is produced is way bigger than the hole which is produced by another normal, you know, our rotatory motor. If this is, you know, ALTAS versus a 8mm punch, this is taken from Hair Transplant Forum International, which is an official publication of ISHRS. This is a side-by-side comparison of ALTAS and 8mm and the wound size compared with a normal punch. Obviously, you are going to have a punch in punch, so you are going to end up. So what happens if your punch size is big? You are going to end up damaging the grafts around this punch, this particular hole. So that is the disadvantage right now with ALTAS, and I'm sure they are going to work around it to, you know, make it more user friendly. So what are the factors which affect extraction? Whether the punches, the torque, the technique, the patient, everything matters once you start extraction. Now in punches, what is important is the size or the diameter of the punch. The type, whether it is a sharp punch, blunt punch, serrated punch or a trumpet kind of a punch, and length or the depth in which you got to go. Ideally, the larger the size, the lesser the transaction. I wish I could take a large punch and put it in, the transaction is going to be less. But the problem is, as I start increasing the size of the punch, I obviously start hitting my neighbors. You know, the neighbor follicles start getting transacted. So the ideal punch size for an Indian patient is 0.9 mm. Obviously, once you start getting more accustomed and more used to, you can start shifting over to 0.8 mm also. But in the initial days, 0.9 mm is good enough. 1 mm would be a little bit more bigger punch, will produce more bigger holes. So try to avoid 1 mm. Now, there is a lot of debate whether it should be a sharp punch or a blunt punch. Sharp punch, you know, there is the margin of error is very less. There is always a more transaction in the hands of a novice when using a sharp punch. But it gives a better healing, and we just need to be precise. With experience and with time, sharp punches will give you a much better wound healing and a much better graft than compared to a blunt punch. But yes, in the initial days, we started off by using blunt punches, and they were much, you know, safer for the hairs. But it doesn't mean that you can, you know, be away from your angle and speed. You still need to be very careful about your angle and speed. And at the end of the day, it is never about the punch. It is all about who is using the punch. Now, these serrated punches have become quite popular. They are available by multiple vendors. Now, serrated punches, whatever mechanism, unknown, but it gives a much better graft when compared to a sharp punch. If you have a sharp punch, an option of using a non-serrated sharp and a serrated sharp, I would say go for the serrated punch. It gives, you know, even in the hands of a novice, it gives a very good graft. A 0.9 mm should be enough. Now, the other concept was developed when Dr. Devroy gave his Wow machine, came up with his Wow machine. He came up with this concept of trumpet punch. This trumpet punch is even used in Mamba Motor. Basically, what happens is that it is just the end of this punch is like a trumpet. You know, it just opens its mouth over here. So when you start going in, more number of tissue is, you know, is got over here. So the transaction rates decrease. But a trumpet punch is best used with an oscillatory motor. Now, using a trumpet punch with a rotatory motor is very difficult. It doesn't penetrate the skin easily. So you have to put more force. Once you give more force, there is more, you know, swaying of the grafts, and there is more transaction. So a trumpet punch is best used with an oscillatory motor. If you are using a rotatory motor like our dental, you know, initially to start off, if you are using the micro motor or something, you can use a serrated punch. It would give you a better graft control and a better graft. Now the question is scale length, like which length punch should we select? There are some 3.5 mm, 5 mm. Some you can change the length depending upon, you know, you can customize the length patient to patient. But generally when you buy non-serrated punch, they give in different lengths. Now, one thing you need to be very careful is when you are operating on Indian patients, especially South Indian patients, I have seen that till, you know, the attachment of the graft goes through and through. As in, till you don't go up to the root, you will never be able to extract this graft. What happens is when you go 3 mm or 4 mm and when you try to extract it, there will be a lot of capping, as in the skin will come out, but this graft will not come out. So in such cases, you have to go deep in. And once you start going deeper, there is always a chance of hitting the roots or damaging the roots. But the key point is that if you have a 5 mm punch, buy one 5 mm punch and keep it with you, you never know when it will come handy. And always, you know, it is never important. It is very important not to go too deep than required. You know, you need to take a few grafts. You get an idea what is the ideal depth that you need to go, and then you need to stop over there. As you know, every case is different. You take a few test grafts, determine the length that is needed in each case. There are no fixed guidelines, you know, as in 3 mm or 5 mm, there are no guidelines over here. Torque or revolutions per minute. It's a very important factor, both whether how much force you are putting in and what is the revolutions you are using per minute. Now it is determined again for individual case, and it gets determined during the initial testing. See, the aim is to keep the speed just above the minimum required. So once you take a few test graphs, you get an idea as to what is the torque or the revolutions you need to keep in the particular patient. You need to remember, we are not plating the mandible. It depends, torque or revolution depends on two factors mainly. It is directly proportional to the toughness of the skin. More softer the skin, lesser the you know, rotations you need. And it is inversely proportional to the sharpness of the punch. As in, if you are using a blunt punch, it's a common sense that you will need more revolutions per minute. Now, this is a important slide where it, you know, this is the cross section of the graft where we are seeing, you know, it is the upper part, it is the attachment up to the erector pili, that is where the attachment is maximum. So you need a strong force over here. So now, as Dr. James Harris has initially tried to made, you know, use a sharp punch here, remove that, put a blunt punch. So Dr. Trivellini came up with this concept that instead of changing the punch, instead of using a sharp punch above and a blunt punch below, what he did is he came up with a change of force. He said that I will use a rotational force in the upper part, and once I go into the lower segment or the lower part, I will start using an oscillatory force. Now, oscillatory force is a weaker force. So the chances of transection or damage to the grafts in the lower part is eliminated. Now, this is the, you know, the normal NSK handpiece and the dental motor which is used. It is only providing rotation. This is the valve motor which provides only oscillation. This is the Mamba motor which has both rotation as well as oscillation. In fact, it has another, it is a triphasic one, not just biphasic. You can have rotation, oscillation, you can add one more mode of vibration or oscillation, whatever you choose. So what happens is, over here, usually this is the setting usually which I keep, there is a 200 milliseconds rotation. As in, when I am in the upper part, I am using rotation. Once I am going lower part, I have started using oscillation. So let's go to the basic steps of FUE. First is obviously, you know, marking and shaving of this area is very important. Then we are going to infiltrate. In infiltration, what is important is you are not going into the subcue. You do not want to elevate. You do not want to do this. You want to make the skin taut. If you want to make the skin taut, you need to make it in the subdermal. You know, just below the dermis is where you need to go. Then the skin becomes taut. The other important point is, then that you need to pull it up. You know, you need to pull this, pull it up and pull it apart. And you have to rest your little finger here and pull it downwards. And then you are ready to extract. This is some of the extractions. This is just showing the rotational motor. I will be showing Mamba also. These are the graphs that are coming out. Now, another important thing that you need to keep in mind when you are operating is that, you know, this is the part of the patient which is, you know, this is the lower part and this is the upper part. You can see a difference over here. It is in the lower part, you can start seeing again, see the effect of retrograde alopecia, especially above the ear. So it is usually in this area we avoid extraction of grafts. Even if we have to, we do very sparse extraction in this area. You can see a large number of grafts are singles over here and they are widely spaced when compared to this area. Now, whenever we are extracting, there are different ways of getting to know whether the kind of graft you are getting. So initially we used to have this method where the assistant used to tell me whether the grafts are good, or whether there is a total transaction, partial transaction, or there is a capping. So, you know, I could modify it on the go. Now we have changed the system. This is how we do nowadays. Nowadays, once the grafts are, extracted, they go to the side table where she separates the single, double, and triple grafts. And then we use this tablet where we are tabulating the number of single, double, triple. So it gives me a real-time idea of the hair per graft ratio in the case. And this is generally what we see. You know, this is just an example of what a transected graft looks like. This is a partially transected graft, and these are the good grafts. You know, this is something which we really need to avoid, the transaction or the partial transaction. This is what we want. We need very good graphs. Even the telos and hairs should come in intact. This is just the Mamba extraction device in action, where you see initially it would rotate, and once it starts going in, it will start oscillating. It is obviously something which is left to imagination. Even with the slow motion, you just get a faint idea as to what's happening. And there is a suction device attached to this. So, you know, it just pulls the graph initially, makes it taut, and then it enters it. Now, this is an example of a 30-year-old guy. 4 to 5 years he's been having hair loss. He's not a smoker, no significant past history. So we have gone ahead and done 2,500 grafts. This is the breakout of the grafts. He had a very good hair per graft ratio. Now, what is important when we are going to do hair transplant is marking of the hairline. Now, there is nothing more important in the whole hair transplantation than marking of the hairline. Now, if you divide the plane of a horizontal and a vertical plane, we need to be somewhere halfway over here. Say about, you know, 6 to 10 centimeters above the gabella is where we need to mark this initial point. And then it goes backwards from here. Very important to put singles in the front row. And it has to placed irregular. The grafts have to placed irregular. The frontal tuft is the second most important area. What we do practically is that a large number of threes which we get, we try to put them in the frontal tuft. A very good frontal tuft will give you a very good result. Our aim is to usually put 40 to 50 grafts per centimeter square. Obviously, as we start going backwards, we start decreasing the density. Our aim is to make sure that, you know, the skin, overlying skin should not be visible.